Good morning. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The first item of business is general questions. In order to get in as many people as possible, I'd be grateful for short and succinct questions and responses. And at question number one, I call Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its priorities are for Scotland's railways in 2022.
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, our priority remains the continued delivery of passenger and freight services to ensure a fair and green recovery from the COVID pandemic. We will mobilise ScotRail Trains Limited, which will provide ScotRail services within the public sector under Scottish Government control. We must ensure passenger services reflect changing passenger needs, and we must restore the financial sustainability of rail services. Our successful support for rail freight will continue as rail freight volumes grow, and we will continue delivery of our rail decarbonisation action plan.
Neil Bibby.
If the Scottish Government want to grow passenger numbers in the new year, then hiking fares is the wrong way to go about it. So further to my topical questions this week to the Minister that were not answered, can I ask, why is the 3.8% hike in fares being introduced in January when even the Tory Government are doing so in March? And why did he tell me on the 16th of December that rail fares remain under consideration and then on the 17th of December announced the biggest fare hike in over a decade?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, as we covered this the other day, it's a matter of deep regret that we've had to introduce these fare increases. The fact that it's in January simply reflects that's when we were due to introduce an increase, if that's what we were going to do. We looked in very great detail about whether it was possible to introduce an increase below RPI. We looked at whether we could have no increase, and we were working on that over an extended period and late into the day.
I call John Mason.
Thank you very much. I wonder if the Minister can assure us that there will continue to be investment in the railways. For example, I think a hydrogen-powered train was trialled during COP26, and will the Government continue to invest to maintain, improve and decarbonise Scotland's railway?
Minister.
President, obviously, the hydrogen train is a very exciting opportunity for us to develop as part of the decarbonisation agenda. We're proud of the record of investment in our railways. Indeed, our budget for 22-23 shows a 42.8%, a £74 million increase from £173 million to £247 million to support improvement to rail infrastructure, including implementation of aspects of our decarbonisation action plan. And overall, the rail budget has seen a 4.3% increase from 2020-2021, which again I think underlines our commitment to this important public service.
I call Graham Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So we've got fare hikes, service cuts, infrastructure projects scrapped. Does the Minister have anything positive to say about the future under a nationalised ScotRail?
Minister.
Glad to see Mr Simpson entering into the Christmas spirit, as ever. And also, the infrastructure project he's alluding to has not been scrapped at all. That project is proceeding and it will deliver the capacity required. As Mr Simpson and I exchanged views on this earlier in the week, I regret the fare increase, which parallels the increase in England. But that is the financial reality we face, as we have to make rail services sustainable in the short, medium and long term.
Question number two is not lodged. Question number three, Rhoda Grant.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to ensure that opportunities for retraining and green skills are available to workers currently employed in the oil and gas sector to enable them to assist in reducing Scotland's carbon emissions.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
The Scottish Government published the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan in December 2020, identifying the immediate and long-term actions needed to ensure our workforce has the skills required to support Scotland's transition to net zero. And as a priority action, within the first 100 days of the Parliament, we launched the Green Jobs Workforce Academy in August 2021, providing individuals of all ages with advice, support and training opportunities to help them enter into or progress in good green jobs. And through the Academy, we are committed to supporting workers within the energy transition, including oil and gas, on and offshore wind, hydrogen, electricity, carbon capture and storage. And this includes the delivery of a skills guarantee for workers in carbon intensive sectors such as oil and gas that will be designed with stakeholders as part of our initial response to the Just Transition Commission.
Rhoda Grant.
In the Highlands and Islands, we have the highest level of fuel poverty. Added to that, there's very few companies that retrofit because micro businesses don't have the resources to register for approved status. And that would enable them to carry out work that is grant funded. Can I ask what the Cabinet Secretary is doing to attract oil and gas workers to retrain in the area and also to enable them and other local contractors to register as approved contractors to supply and to ensure a supply of local contractors available to retrofit in areas where they are most needed?
Minister.
Yep, I thank Rhoda Grant for those points. They're very, very important points, and I can certainly identify with them in my own constituency in Moray in the north of Scotland as well. That's one of the reasons why we did set up the Green Jobs Workforce Academy, and I'm told that nearly 3,400 people, unique users, have already visited that website just the first couple of months of it being set up. So there is a resource available for anyone working within the oil and gas sector, as well as through the official initiatives, many of which are in the northeast of Scotland, to find out about the opportunities in renewables and how to retrain and get accredited for some of these important sectors that's really important for the transition that Rhoda Grant mentioned. But of course, I absolutely accept it's a long way to go here, and that's why we are working with our colleges and our further education sector, and the Minister for Green Skills, Lorna Slater, is working hard on those issues as well.
Thank you. We need a little more brevity, please. Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The UK's £16 billion North Sea Transition Deal, which launched last March, aims to transition 40,000 oil and gas jobs in the next 8 years. The Scottish Government has allocated just £20 million to a Just Transition Fund. What precisely is the £20 million for, and what are the stated year one outcomes?
Minister.
Can I say to Liam Kerr, I'm delighted the UK Government are investing resources into the North Sea after taking £300 billion plus out over the last few decades. It's good to get something back again for the northeast of Scotland. And it's an important initiative. And in terms of the Scottish Government's Transition Fund for northeast Scotland over the next 10 years, we're working hard with stakeholders and we'll make further announcements in the new year in terms of the first £20 million of that, which is in the draft budget before Parliament just now.
Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Energy policy remains reserved to UK ministers, so can the Minister advise the opportunities for green skills and green jobs that have been lost from terrible decision-making from UK ministers? While they invest billions in expensive nuclear power, they have underinvested in what the tidal industry needs, shamefully chosen not to award Track 1 status to the Scottish Cluster's carbon capture project, and also cut subsidies for renewables.
Briefly, Minister.
Neil Gray highlights the massive potential to create hundreds of thousands of green jobs in Scotland, and the recent decision by the UK Government not to place the Acorn project in Track 1 in terms of the carbon capture project is of course a blow to creating these green jobs. There's over 15,000 jobs expected in the early stages of that project alone, and it's really important that the UK Government reverse its decision. So there is massive potential. There's been many, many different reports, I don't have time to quote, that outline the potential for hundreds of thousands of new green jobs in Scotland.
Question number 4, Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government for the total value of applications received from local authorities as part of the £32 million local bridge maintenance scheme.
Minister Tom Arthur.
The Scottish Government received 131 applications for funding from the Local Bridge Maintenance Fund at a total estimated value of £107.7 million. A total of 74 applications from 19 local authorities have been approved.
Dean Lockhart.
I thank the Minister for that response. The collapse of several bridges in rural Stirlingshire has caused significant disruption for local residents and businesses. Given the oversubscription to the Bridge Maintenance Fund, which the Minister just outlined, and the urgent need for bridge repairs across many regions, what assurances can the Minister provide that there will be more funding available in the future to carry out the necessary repairs?
Minister.
Well, I thank the member for his supplementary question. Of course, there was £10 million allocated within, I beg your pardon, £12 million allocated within this financial year, and £20 million will be allocated next year. But it's also important to look at the wider context. The local government capital grant for next year will increase by £62.5 million, which is a 10.1% cash increase or a 7.2% real terms increase. So ultimately, there's additional capital resource for local government, and it is for local government to make decisions upon how to deploy that capital resource, including for local bridge maintenance, based upon their own priorities.
Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Minister agree with me that bridge repairs have been impacted by labour and skill shortages and building supply issues that have been exacerbated by the Tories' hard Brexit, pushed through against Scotland's democratic will?
Minister, briefly.
I think the member raises an important point. I think we're all aware of the increasing cost of capital investment as a consequence of skill shortages and indeed supply shortages. Now, of course, there's a number of factors that are impacting upon that and creating that problem, but a key one, of course, has been the UK government's reckless hard Brexit.
Thank you. Question number five, Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what measures it has taken to prevent the casual purchase of pets for Christmas.
Cabinet Secretary Marie Goujon.
We understand why some families might be tempted to get a puppy as a gift at Christmas, but we would be encouraging people to really think very carefully about doing that, because Christmas is probably the worst time of year to bring a puppy into a household, because it needs a calm environment and an established routine to help it adjust to its new life and surroundings. We also know that the lead up to Christmas is when the unscrupulous puppy farmers are looking to cash in on the increased demand. So the chances of buying an illegally bred and sick puppy are even higher than they would normally be. In the run-up to Christmas, and in support of the Scottish SPCA's ongoing campaign, we've released social media messaging to discourage prospective owners from buying a puppy for Christmas. Our messaging also provides advice on how to spot the signs of an unlicensed dealer. And there are key checks that can help ensure you're buying safely. Those include meeting the puppy's mother with her litter and ensuring that all the correct paperwork is in place. And if something doesn't feel right, walk away and report your concerns to the Scottish SPCA.
Christine Graham.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer. And campaigns and advice have their place, and they're very important. Yet, as the Cabinet Secretary has already said, illegal puppy trading from horrendous puppy factory farms and purchasing online continues. Often, as the Cabinet Secretary said, sick animals, and then a great deal of distress and unhappiness for the owners. Will the Cabinet Secretary support in principle my Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill, which fell last session due to time pressures, and which I intend to lodge early in the year, to encourage in law responsible dog ownership? And by the way, Cabinet Secretary, a yes would make my Christmas.
Cabinet Secretary.
Oh, I thank the member for her question, and I know that this, she's very passionate about animal welfare and has been looking to pursue this for some time. And of course, the Scottish Government welcomes any proposal that seeks to improve animal welfare in Scotland. And so we will, of course, be considering the content of the member's bill carefully, and I really look forward to discussing the measures set out on it in due course and working together with Christine Graham on the measures she's looking to introduce.
Question number six, Marie McNair. Ms McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how its plans to bring ScotRail into public ownership are progressing.
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, on the 8th of December, I provided the Net Zero Committee with an update on arrangements to mobilise a wholly owned company, ScotRail Holdings Limited, and its wholly owned subsidiary, ScotRail Trains Limited. ScotRail Trains Limited will operate ScotRail services on expiry of the current franchise. ScotRail Holdings will provide oversight and management of ScotRail Trains Limited. The appointments of the Chief Executive Officer and Finance Director of Scottish Rail Holdings Limited was announced on the 10th of December. I will, of course, keep Parliament updated as mobilisation arrangements progress and as significant milestones are reached. Additionally, Presiding Officer, I am looking into the possibility of providing MSPs access to an additional informal briefing session in order for them to hear directly from some of the senior appointments and ask any additional questions they might have.
Marie McNair.
The Minister will agree that reliable and efficient railways are the backbone of the transport system. My constituents have raised concerns regarding the impact of the proposed changes to trains on the Mogai Line. Whilst there's no doubt the pandemic has had significant impact on passenger numbers, what assurances can the Scottish Government give that the views of my constituents will be fully considered by ScotRail?
Minister.
My understanding is that ScotRail have been actively analysing around 3,500 responses to the recent consultation and services and will inform stakeholders, including MSPs, of the consultation outcomes together with its response to those in due course. I would anticipate that happening early in the new year, although I'm sure the member will appreciate right now their immediate focus is on providing services and delivering the mobilisation. But I can reassure the member that Transport Scotland will be seeking assurances from ScotRail that the views of all respondents to the consultation have been appropriately considered. And whilst I'm aware that ScotRail has developed a proposed timetable that seeks to offer service patterns that meet passenger forecasts, I would expect, in light of evidence promoted through the consultation, they'll be considering adjustments to that proposed timetable.
Daniel Johnson.
Officer, it was heartening to hear about the plans for public ownership of Scotland's railways, but will the Minister commit now to full worker representation on the board of those governance structures that he just outlined?
Minister.
I think I've outlined previously, Presiding Officer, that the intention is to have staff representation on the board.
Thank you. Question number 7, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it will ensure that every GP has access to a dedicated mental wellbeing link worker.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government is making significant investment in the development of mental health and wellbeing in primary care services. This includes the implementation of our manifesto commitment provide 1,000 additional dedicated roles by 2026 to help grow community mental health resilience and increase the use of social prescribing. These new services will be established within areas served by a group of GP practices. They will be made up of multi-agency teams providing assessment, advice, support and some levels of treatment for people who have mental health distress or wellbeing needs. Every service will ensure that it provides access to a link worker for mental wellbeing. And the Scottish Government has recently allocated £1.5 million of funding from the Mental Health Recovery and Renewal Fund and issued local planning guidance to health boards and integration authorities to support early planning for these services.
Karen Adam.
I thank the Minister for his answer. Presiding Officer, LGBT plus people have a higher need for mental health care due to inequalities ingrained in our society, particularly in rural communities like mine, where there is not often a natural support network available. We often lose these constituents to larger cities with greater LGBT plus resources and support. Does the Minister agree with me that these mental health workers are essential to ensure we can offer support to these individuals and reduce some of their inequalities within our rural communities?
Briefly, Minister.
Presiding Officer, I agree with Karen Adam that when these services are established, they will often be the first port of call for LGBT plus individuals accessing mental health support and treatment. People will be able to access these services quickly and easily to prevent mental ill health from escalating. In guidance issued, HSCPs are required to equality impact assess their local plans, which will be based on the specific needs of their local populations, including LGBT plus individuals. Presiding Officer, we recognise that in remote and rural communities in particular, we have to ensure that we have high quality, sustainable healthcare services. And I believe that our plans in this area will go a long way in helping people in these communities too.
Yes, I'm afraid we have to conclude general questions at this point, and my apologies to those members that we've been unable to take today. So that